this to be spread by consumers. When advertising has never been like that. I mean, the great adverts are loved, but it's never been the case where you had a mechanism to share it. No one recorded a TV ad that they loved, which all of us would know, and passed it on to their friend. It's great when it works, and that can almost create a false idol, because everyone goes, oh, it worked for Old Spice, or you know, every now and again there's a success criteria, but globally you're talking about a handful per year. And Dove, I think, it's on the way there, 40 million views, so it's high, but a TV campaign in Indonesia hits more than 40 million views over the course of a month.
Sometimes I think the way the brands lead their campaigns and failure is the way they treat it. You mean digital campaign, guys? The way they treat digital campaigns like a regular traditional campaign. So make it a one-way thing, not engaging enough, or full branding. Because in a CBC, you only have 30 seconds. So what do you need 30 seconds? Of course, you bombard them with every single branding possibility that you have. But in digital, you have so many other options. And I think the other thing is, sometimes in Indonesia, what I see is more of a copy mode campaign. If it's successful there, then it will be successful here. For instance, the TNT video, right? The one where somebody presses a button and then suddenly the whole drama comes alive and then it gets like millions and millions of views. You know, I've seen like a lot of brands trying to do something like that. It's funny. I'm like, sure, because if it's good there, but if it's to your brand, how's it going to be funny? And I think you're right, to your point, I think support of brands actually hope that consumers spread that their campaign will go viral by itself, by consumer. I think it's an overstatement. Cannot be. It has to be supported by paid somewhere in the process because it's called advertising and we are marketers with marketing budgets. But at the end of the day, then we need to have a good proportion of the paid and unpaid versions. I think that's
And so as PR plays an important part, see? Like, you know, Gangnam Style, people would call it, is actually, you know, entertainment. Okay, Gangnam Style is over here. When it comes, like, very booming, it's because of, like, all of the intents or whatever it is, insert whatever it is.
It's more fragmented, but with Gangnam Style, would you rather have a pre-roll ad that ran before Gangnam Style, which is a long form, or relatively long, it's not 30 seconds. Would you rather have that across 100 million views, or create your own dancing Korean guy as a brand ambassador and get a million views? One, you own it. One, you're solely responsible for it. And it lasts 3 minutes. The other lasts, you know, 30 seconds before something that everyone wants to do. So you don't need to produce the content. You can do what advertisers always done and put itself next to the content. I think it's quite ambitious to produce the content. And when it works, it's fantastic. As you guys are no doubt finding out, all the awards you're no doubt getting for Dove.
More the attention, knowing your passion. A couple months ago, I built an app. It's in a short time before knowing exactly who is our target. We just know that our target is on Facebook, this, and this. And when we build an app, after 3 months, we know that most of our target is on mobile, where our apps is not compatible on mobile, and that is something that really waste, because the minority of our target is like the apps, but most of our target is on mobile, so it's something that needs to be considered first.
And we're discussing about, I mean, like, what actually differentiates advertorial with this native ads, and like that's it, you know, like, and how will it like give value to the brand, right? So I was like thinking as well, you know, like based on discussion, like how like for example, you know, like when we look at something that is there's currently trending, right? Like most of the time, like either we want to write on it or we want to you know, like optimize it with like placing our app on the content, like, for example, or like looking at like the social insight, you know, like why people like this kind of content, and then like, you know, like apply it on our campaign, and then the question is, most of the time, people feel that when we do brand campaign, right? Most people feel that this is just another piece of advertising. This is you are trying to sell your products to me, right? So that's why native ads is actually something that is I think is very hot in the United States right now, because they develop advertising content want to talk about, and with being a bit humble, and that it's not only talking about your brand, but making it from the consumer.
Now state whether consumer will get the message or not, but for this kind of making a video, it's just like we take it for granted. We just make a video and then just hoping that it will go higher, but in fact it's not, because we don't have that kind of mechanism that would determine whether this would be a worthwhile comment on the product, which is
in the short term is incredibly valuable. We find Facebook to be a reach medium in most markets because the sheer number of users, then you can reach a significant proportion of them if you spend the right money. You don't have the ability to communicate who you are and what you stand for, so you get to introduce yourself and say, this is a new product.
How many of you have run a digital campaign? Have you run a digital campaign before?
Yeah,
do you have can you share for example how if there's digital campaign that is actually failed, what is behind it?
It gets social chaos to wrap it. So it's quite different, and we cannot tap into that kind of thing year by year. It's just for a quick awareness and quick quick things in that beginning of time. And for now, I think it's more we're still.
Let's say it's a very successful, but I don't know how true it is. So I don't know any of you knows about this, and maybe you can share, because this is to answer your question whether it works or not. Because the way when I first noticed it started, it's I think they're using Foursquare also, right? In North Malaysia, yeah. And then Foursquare at that time was still new and not many people using it. And then I basically don't know their KPI, but what I heard is very successful. So I was just curious, how can it be successful that using Foursquare while not many people using Foursquare? That's one thing. And second thing, I came across their ad almost everywhere I go, which means they spent a lot of money to inform people about the games. So then my question is, sometimes, is it really worth it? You are trying to engage your consumer, but you are actually spending a lot of money instead of advertising on your brand, then you are advertising on your games or your apps. That's the things I always notice. Yeah?
It's putting the cart before the horse almost. So you're kind of saying, we really want this marketing device to do well, so we'll spend loads of money advertising this marketing device, but you're kind of getting it the wrong way around. If it's a good marketing device, it should do that job for you.
Yeah, so that's why but then back to the question, does it work or does it work? It depends on how you look at it. If I'm the marketeers of, it works, because maybe you give me a number of these people playing the game, engage me, but at the end of the day, it's only so much money. I always having that dilemma. Yeah, I always have that dilemma when I work with agency, and then they come with this proposal. Oh, Chris, it's so brilliant. But then you have to advertise it. You have to make TVC, that's to advertise these games, and then you have to do your PR.
You have to see the impact to the sales.
Exactly. I'm creating something, advertising this something. Why don't I just use that money to advertise on my brand? I probably get the same sales too.
Knowing the target audience, and then again, advertising something that is that is not too intrusive, but making people actually play with it. So, so that is so why a lot of brands now and Nintendo.
Magazine ad, because you're using that magazine's mode of address, you're maybe even using its content producers, maybe some of the writers are writing your copy or your article. So that's great. And I think those per impression or per exposure basis, they're very impactful formats of advertising, whether it's a game unit on a game site or an advertorial written by a writer from a magazine in the magazine that it's designed for. So I think they have an important part to play in the wider kind of mix, but they're always like the pinnacle, the most impactful, the strongest executions, but not the scalable ones necessarily. No, it's the perfect fusion of medium and message, which is what everyone strives for, but it comes at a price, I think.
And the next question is, how cool and how do you make the great execution? Yes. But they don't struggle with the Super Bowl edition of material. So,
we have 5 minutes more. So, just to recap, right? An advertising is like how we can actually deliver a great campaign. And avoid ourselves to actually lead it into a value is the content needs to be genuine because when it you actually touch human emotion and most of the time people will remember it more than either it's funny ones shoot. Has it own roles and all that, and then and it goes to setting the right objective and the right metrics because sometimes the way we want it's still based on the metrics of measuring conventional advertising or for example
talking about okay you want to invest in Prime Oil, great, you will do 20% revenue, it's true. But if you invest in that, your leverage will be 1,000%, 2,000%. I mean, the world is capital risk. Yeah, the risk is higher. And you are talking, you need investor who understand that they are investing in something different, intangible asset. I don't know, what's the asset of Google? You know what I mean? So I'm just saying, if for me, that's one of the problems. I don't want to talk to these guys. They don't interest me, and I know for sure I don't interest them. Because if you challenge investing in a startup, whatever it is, in apps or versus investing in Palm Oil, we don't talk the same language. Go to the Palm Oil. I'm telling you, go to the Palm Oil. The problem, I think, is there's too much Palm Oil and not enough.
Let me finish the story as well. Now I'm on the other side. Okay. Now I'm in the middle and I get confused because of what happened. That you know that if we look into our CFOs nowadays, I mean CFOs is a really very pragmatic and traditionalist people. You know, the way that they do the CFA, for example, has been a long. I mean the example of their books in CFA or CPA or whatever. Never, you know, been discussed about the startup. Okay, it's all about the direct accounting, you know, all this kind of stuff. Every time that you know that I look at it now, if you said that Indonesia is actually that having a lot of a problem because of what happened is that look into what happened to Plaza.com. I mean, there are a lot of money being invested by Telkom. Okay. It's a very rich as a company. They put a lot of money into Plaza.com to build e-commerce. Now where it is failed. We just met a couple of guys, the president director as well, several of startups, and they said that look, you know, nobody currently, everybody is skin in the red, okay? And look into another, you know, company. It's such a pity that Multiply also have a lot of difficulties, now gone, disappeared, and they ceased their operation. And it give a very, very bad image to the whole industry. That you know, if you invest in a startup, then you know, then it's as simple as you just burn the money. Okay. Now actually, that I'm also in the trouble because of, you know, I'm in the middle. Okay, should I put the money, or should I just keep the money and put it into something else? Now that's the reason why, you know, I joined this group. I hope that you can give me also some valuable thinking and sharing from different countries' experience. I personally still believe that there is a market and, you know, and a business for this digital world. But then, how much money that we are talking about? Okay, if we are talking about this amount, for example, then okay lah. I mean, if we lost it, we lost it. All right, but cannot be like telecom in such that they pay immediate. After that, after you know this failed, now they work together with eBay. Okay, to create another, you know, another platform, another, you know, commerce, and I mean, you know, if I don't know what if they fail, so that's the situation nowadays in the country.
Actually, I'm just doing this because I don't have any experience.
No, but even without experience, you can have a perception.
Okay, I'll pass first. I'll get then.
So, very interesting comments. I just wanted to come back on it. To me, so now I've started to move into a realm of doing small, like angel investments, small scale investments. So now I'm also starting to look at it in a way the way you look at it as an investment. This is a very high risk area. This is exactly, I think, the comments. Absolutely true. Much higher risk than palm oil. Palm oil, you can kind of plan. I can understand the returns of it. Setting up an internet company, very high rates of failure, right? But it's then to me all about the portfolio you invest in, because you need that, you know, this is what I always heard about VCs in the States. You invest in 10 companies, right? Maybe 7 of them will die, 2 of them will be okay, one will shoot to the moon. If you have one shoot to the moon, you're fine. You'll get the returns in the whole portfolio. In Indonesia, I mean, there's clearly failures. But there's also successes like Coprol. To me, it was a great success for the founders. Unfortunately, they seem to have closed down the service. But if you talk about the investors made money. They sold to Yahoo, the investors made money.
Just to rebound on what you were saying, you don't know why they closed. I mean, maybe Yahoo wanted to close it because they have their own system.
Right. You should get Ken.
Yeah, actually, so you don't know, maybe they buy a competitor to close it. So in this case, it's a success.
Yeah.
You were talking about Multiply. I know very well the Multiply. The president of Multiply Philippines is the president of the DCOM Association, the one I'm vice president. We are quite close friends. And to give you an example, for me, there's nothing surprising that this company closed. Actually, it's healthy. You're talking about an investor, MIH, who is owning Sulit, which is the biggest number one website in Philippines for directory. A lot of people have shopped on Sulit. And on the other way, you have Multiply, which is not a number one, not even a number two. We don't have any business model. We don't make money since 3 years. They launch a new platform, which is supposed to be the platform is 1 year late, and they release a crap. The guy just take a healthy business decision. Instead of spreading money on two players, which I have, I put all my effort on my champion, and I closed that one. The only thing who surprised people was maybe the violence the CEO learned on Wednesday, but the company was closing on Friday. On that aspect, yeah, but I agree with you. It's not, at first look, a good signal. But on the other way, for me, it's very healthy.
I agree for the industry to help. Or look at someone like Desik.com. I mean, to me, that's an excellent business. Has continued to grow, has returned very well to the early founders and investors. So, yeah, I think you need to take a wider view. And I think for a market like Indonesia, I'm based in Singapore. And just in the last year, I'm traveling
with an agency or startup.
Agency.
Agency.
Yeah.
agency.
All right.
Maybe we'll just do the first bit. Be quick to the block. So, are agencies dinosaurs? Is there something fundamentally wrong with the agency model? And does it need to change? Or is agencies kind of okay? So the reason that I wanted to talk about this topic was I kind of straddled both worlds. So started an agency, the agency was bought by WPP, now we're in sort of the big, wonderful WPP world. As a digital agency person, myself and my partners also really, you know, I think a lot of times you come up with ideas and you're like, why don't clients get how fantastic this idea is? So in the end, we decided to actually start to build some of these things and realize it's not as easy as it seems, and it's very, very easy to lose money, not as easy to build things, but I think there's a lot of joy in being able to innovate fast and come up with ideas and build them out. So but I think there's a lot of issues with the way that startups get up and running. So I just wanted to kind of throw open the discussion, particularly around, you know, people in agencies tend to grumble a lot, but is that just, do we actually all love the way agencies work? Is that just part of the course? Or do we think that there's fundamentally things that agencies need to do and change, otherwise their businesses over the coming years will start to sort of be disintermediated by new models, start to disintegrate and die. Maybe we'll throw it to Matt, so I know he has.
What do you define as wrong? What's your definition of wrong?
Spelling? He will remain nameless, but he was saying, and he's currently employed by WPP, but he was saying, I just feel like, is there something wrong with the WPP model? And in 5, 10, 20 years, will WPP's kind of reason for being so powerful start to die? And that is, in a sense, WPP is all about the power of scale. But it's not able to move fast. And you have new startups constantly coming up, and they're moving fast. And are they going to start to disintermediate big agencies? And will very quickly the whole power of being big start to become less and less relevant?
I think that the evolution in our industry at the moment is fundamental, probably the greatest it's ever been, and that's led by media. So you've got a media change that was humans that are so disparate now versus what we've had in, you know, 3 or 4 channels over the last 50 years, effectively. This last 10 years has really changed our industry. I think as an industry we've been slow to catch up. I think we have to or we will die. What the model is, where we end up, I don't have the answer. But if every agency now who considers itself a brand agency doesn't want to consider itself a digital agency, it's not. You know, we're talking in the last group about stuff, so creative stuff. Because even now, in a market like Vietnam, I can't have a traditional team of creative and a digital team. I need to have someone who thinks with both hats on at the same time. I need a digital, predominantly digitally focused person. Do ATL, not the other way around. Because 60% of my revenue is digital now already. Mind that I can use that dictate. I think that as these startups happen, as all these new companies come aboard, or as they emerge, they will get snapped up again. So I don't think that WPP will fail, or it just, I think it needs to evolve as well. I think that the tragedy is this great culture and ideas, and speed to market, speed of thinking, which will get lost by the WPP process. I agree with that.
It's interesting how fast we can innovate for clients, right? The client can tell us, give me a response tomorrow, and we'll spend all night, we'll come out with stuff, and it can be amazing. It can be amazing ideas, which is kind of what a startup does, right? Amazing ideas. But for our own business, we can't do that.
Yeah, I think we service our own businesses a lot. It's a fundamental problem. It's something I'm very conscious of. I try to do a little bit differently. Yeah, but we're not great at it as an industry. I think that we're so focused, we are so client focused, and there's a good side of that, which is we are so client focused and we're worried about their business equally as our own, predominantly caught there in front of our own. That can be detrimental. But it's like, you know, talk about a tradie, right? Plumber's always got the worst plumbing, and your mechanic's always got the worst car. It's not too dissimilar, and that's the ages old. So.
Is there anyone else?
I agree wholeheartedly. I was at MediaCon London 5 years ago.
seen as media comes back to office, and when I started there was a very fine distinction between you are digital, you are traditional, and you might have a little chat every now and then, but basically these are my budgets and you're not giving me that.
That ownership thing.
Yeah. And by the time I left, MediaCom were making conscious efforts. We're not going to have any traditional media. We're going to start hiring digital people, and if anything, we will teach them how to do traditional, because digital is the thing, and that's a complete reverse to how it used to be at least in Asia, because the MediaCom market is so small that you end up having to do everything.
Right.
So you're almost forced to learn the offline and the online, which is great. And I think in the long term, it will set things up very well, but I don't think it's a conscious decision for the betterment of the staff and the business. I think you're just forced to do everything you have to do.
That can be an advantage.
Yeah.
The bigger the organisation, the slower the change, right? So they can identify that cascading that through 200 offices globally is a lot harder than someone at a local level saying, fuck, we need to do something. And fundamentally, like, if I go and change my office, I'm going to be noticed as a manager, I'm going to be noticed and have better career opportunities personally by doing it at that level rather than waiting for the change to come the other way as well. So that's something for me.
Well, I don't know, what you were saying about you now cannot even get a differentiation between above the line and digital.
No, I can get differentiation. I don't want to.
You don't want to. Yeah, I mean, like, I agree with that.
Nielsen, for example, I found, and sorry, we've already had this in previous sessions, but a very low correlation between clicks down to ROI. Ultimate business objective, and people should, and advertisers should be, especially in the digital space, should be optimizing for reach rather than clicks, because reach has been found to provide better ROI than optimizing for clicks, because there's no correlation whatsoever. So I know I'm kind of skirting around with the answer, but it's selling it in the right value, positioning the right value in the right way rather than.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
What is Facebook?
Yeah, another tough question. I would say
ad revenue. What have you?
Look, ad revenue, we always kind of, right?
Google, number two.
Number two,
Google.
Again. Yeah, look, those you'd expect. The Googles and the Yahoos.
Well, right? And certainly where you're going.
Yeah.
Not traditional channels.
They're not traditional.
Channels have gone online.
No.
These are startups, digital companies. That are generating all the revenue and doing having a much more profitable, successful business than the traditional media channels these days.
Yeah, absolutely.
Something on that. We've totally got off topic.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. And in fact, maybe just also a bit off topic. But if we expand our topic, so we'll talk about particularly about agencies and what they should learn from startups. And if we look at that in terms of threats to the agency model, right? So I want to come back to later do we need to change anything in our model? We're seeing now publishing houses, not so much the Facebooks of the world, but premium publishers, like I think the guys who, the Pearson Group, or one of the groups now, and I know recently I was seeing Vice.com has created this whole unit which will create beautiful, edgy, branded content for brands. And you think, well, if I'm going to go and get content credit, it's edgy, well, maybe I should go to Vice. And if it's business guys, maybe I should go to Forbes. You know, maybe they're the ones who understand how to create this content better than I as the agency. So is that agency model of effectively hours, you know, you pay for our formats other than, you know, hours for output?
Yeah, so, from a media perspective, MediaCom about 18 months ago launched their MBA unit, which was their anything above your standard display, and it's essentially a consultancy. So while we will still perform things like a mobile buy or there's a social buy, it gets firmly plugged into a project by project fee where the bulk of the new revenue comes from a consultancy. So you get past the hours, and it seems to be very successful. They've launched MBA in about 25 markets now, so it looks like that's where MediaCom are throwing their hat in the ring and saying this is how we're going to get past, you know, traditional commission buying.
Right. So you kind of moved on from the commission model, and you're looking at sort of high value strategic consultants,
exactly.
But still sold on an hourly basis, most of
yes.
I mean, that's sort of that. So, and this kind of McKinsey model, and I've seen, I think it's Bain or something, which shows the share price of companies that use them versus companies that don't use them,
right?
Show kind of shareholder value. But I'm curious, every now and then I hear, not very often, but I hear someone that's done, has run a campaign and they've got maybe equity in the company as a result. So they've taken a percentage of revenue in the company.
Too fast. What did you write?
Fuel Man.
Fuel Man.
Pebble.
Robot and the other player.
Pebble.
Right.
Pebble. What is the Pebble? Is it a watch?
I forgot to turn it. But yeah, it's a watch with a programmable interface that has then an API which I can do notifications. What I really love about it is that I can change watch faces and things like that, so you get some kind of aesthetic appeal out of it. But it has kind of